Along the coastline, the waves, currents, wind, and any rivers entering the sea all work together to transport sediment. Whenever waves, rivers, and wind lose their energy, deposition occurs. That means any sediment being transported is dropped. Along coastlines, this can result in the formation of features such as beaches, dunes, spits, and tombolos. Beaches form when sediment is deposited on the shore by the swash of constructive waves. Sediment found on the beach can include silt, sand, gravel, and boulders. The composition, colour, and size of sand on a given beach is the result of the local rocks that it came from. For example, the erosion of cliffs or rivers that transport material to the sea. This is combined with the coastal processes that modified it over the long term. Many beaches contain a lot of silica, also known as quartz. Quartz is the most common mineral on the Earth's continental crust. In between the sand grains, one also finds the remains of ground-up shells, which are made of calcium carbonate. The top part of the beach is usually always dry, and there is another part that is always submerged. The intertidal zone of the beach is the area that is above water at low tide and submerged at high tide. Waves can either build up beaches or erode them. It is normal for beaches to have a summer and a winter profile. Smaller waves have a stronger swash than backwash and build beaches up in the summer. They are called constructive waves. The deposition of material by waves can form a sand ridge called a berm, which marks the edge of the swash zone. During winter, there are frequent storms. Waves are higher and more frequent. These waves have a stronger backwash than swash and erode the beach. These are called destructive waves. Sand and other material is transported along the beach by a process known as longshore drift. How it works is that the prevailing wind direction will cause the waves to approach the beach at an angle. As a result, the sediment that moves up the beach with swash will be moved at an angle. Likewise, the backwash will move the sediment back down the beach at an angle. Thus, sediment will travel back and forth along the beach in a zigzag-like motion. If longshore drift occurs predominantly in one direction and then encounters a river mouth or a change in direction of the coastline, sediment can be deposited forming an extension of the coastline known as a spit. The diffraction of waves bend around islands, taking sediment with them. Eventually, when enough sediment is built up, the spit will fully connect with an island and form a tombolo, such as this one. Sometimes, longshore drift will cause the sand to deposit right across the river mouth, forming a bar. As a consequence, many bars have lagoons and wetlands behind them. Longshore drift along the east coast of Australia is also responsible for the creation of giant sand islands off Queensland's coast, such as North and South Stradbroke Island, Bribey Island, and Fraser Island. Sand dunes are an accumulation of sand grains. Sand dunes form when wind carries sand up the beach and deposits it in a heap around an obstacle like a piece of driftwood or vegetation. Aeolian processes are the action of wind. Sand will not be moved until the wind reaches a velocity fast enough to move the particles of sand. This is called the fluid threshold velocity. Large particles require higher wind velocity to be moved than finer particles. However, in wet climates, sand particles are more difficult for wind to pick up, as wet sand tends to clump together. Sand moves by surface creep, which is sand rolling along the ground, the suspension of smaller particles in the air, or by saltation, for process of saltation involves particles being lifted a small distance into the air only for them to fall back to the surface under the force of gravity and strike other sand grains. The grains that are hit by the saltating grains are forced by kinetic energy to move themselves. Saltation accounts for most of the movement by sand. If there is a drop in wind velocity, deposition will occur. Dunes classically have a gradual upwind slope and a steep downwind slope. Sand dunes don't form anywhere, they require special conditions to form. Firstly, dunes require an abundant supply of sediment. Beaches and deserts are examples of environments where vast supplies of loose sediment exist. Secondly, dunes require ample wind energy to be able to pick up sand grains and transport them. Thirdly, beaches with large tidal ranges and a gentle sloping gradient are more likely to have dunes as there is more time for sand to dry out enough for wind to pick up the sand grains. Finally, dunes require an ideal location for sand to accumulate. Dunes such as these ones have an extensive backshore area where sand can accumulate. You don't find dunes at places where there are cliffs, preventing the inland spread of sand. The dunes that are closest to the sea are called the foredune. In Australia, native plants are often the first species to colonise the foredune. As the roots of these plants bind the sand together, the dunes are stabilised. Close behind these plants on the foredunes and on the back dunes, where there is more protection from wind and salt, small shrubs and trees such as banksias, coastal she-oak, and wattles may grow. These trees have adapted to help them survive in these low nutrient and salty environments. They are often wetlands behind frontal dunes, which are dominated by paperbark trees.